How do you see the demand of sub-classifying the reservation policy, SCs? So that, do you see it as a policy matter, or do you see the way the Madhyas or Arundhutis in Tamil Nadu, I'm not sure whether, and Valmikis in North India, I'm not sure whether Mans are raising this demand here. So do you see it as a in a law? Do you see it is a political message they're giving, or you see it as a policy matter, technical matter?
Yeah, let me answer it in a very legal term.
And also, before going to that, if you know the history, if you know the history of this movement, whether it is there, you can give a background.
See, what constitution recognizes is scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. So if you see the scheduled caste order, it includes caste and races and various categories or groups. Now what is recognized is all those who fall within the category of scheduled caste are given this right. The right is not given only on the basis of caste. Okay. So your caste fall within the category of scheduled caste or scheduled tribe, and therefore you being a member of that community, you have a constitutional right, maybe for reservations and all other privileges which are guaranteed by constitution. And therefore, technically, constitution doesn't make a distinction that you have a reservation on the basis of caste, and therefore technically when you make a demand that our caste need to have an X amount of share, that is constitutionally an illegal demand, because the framework of constitution doesn't allow you to do that. So you can maximum say that my caste falls within the category of scheduled caste. My caste falls within the category of scheduled tribe or either of the categories which you have. But you can't say that my caste deserve X amount of percentage because I am so much in the category. So technically it is not possible, and that is also a Supreme Court judgment on the same. So and let us take an example. What we're talking about, that if you see that Mars and Mangs in Maharashtra, and they say that okay, you have 7% and we'll have 8%, or you have 8% and we'll have 7%, either all if calculation you have. What are you going to do with all other small communities who are 0.1%, 0.2%, 0.3% or small other percentage? So the problem will be that these communities will never be represented.
No, but even for that also, the way the demand is coming, sub-classifying, for example, ABCD reservation.
See, the ABCD reservations again are not possible in the case of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, because these are the constitutional categorizations which are made. No, so you have to go for a constitutional amendment for that. You have to go for constitutional amendment for that, and then in that case again you can't have a parameter of caste. You can have a parameter of backwardness put up into this, is saying that okay, this amount of backwardness will fall within A, B and C, D. This is not possible again with scheduled caste, because scheduled caste are being categorized for a very different historical reasons, not as compared to the OBCs. See, what happened with the OBCs, with NT, A, B, C, D and other part we have, is that their categorization is not the same parameter of categorization which the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe had. Our parameter was the Government of India Act 1935 and the Star Committee report, which spoke about people who are outcast and what are the parameters for that. If you're sharing the same parameters at that point of time, then you being a member of scheduled caste is something different from being a member of other backward class. So I suppose again this logic would fail, we put for ABCD categorization, because it applies more for the OBCs and then to the scheduled caste. So this could be a technical point raising it. The next point which you have raised is what is the political message it gives? It definitely gives a political message that all other caste who are not the dominating caste in the politics or in social politics for last 50 years are asserting that we have not got a share. And I think that is more serious, and that need to be addressed seriously. So whether the constitutional scheme permits you to go to look into the matter is a very technical legal question. But a sociological question is that, are we going to address this question that all those caste which gets a feeling that we didn't got a share, a reasonable share in the development in the scheduled caste itself, that need to be addressed, and that has to look into that for what reasons they didn't ever got a share. Because if opportunities are equally available, then in that case why is it so that one person doesn't get an opportunity or doesn't get and other person does get it? So there may be various reasons that access to education post-independence also, a late access to education for certain caste and early access to education for few caste might have brought a amount of difference. Because all those caste who were involved in Ambedkarite movement pre-independent India, or who were involved in anti-caste movement pre-independent India, are the developed caste post-independent India, because they had education with them, they were in employment for some time. And sociologically, all those caste who came up in education very late, or post-constitution who came up in education, definitely the opportunities for them will come out very late. And that has to be addressed seriously right now, because we can't just do away with, ignore these issues.
One more thing, sir. I think this is the first time such information came actually. One more thing is, the Madhyas in Andhra Pradesh and Arundhatiyas in Tamil Nadu, what they are saying is, one point they also agree to the fact is that they are educationally backward for two, three reasons they give. One is the Christianity which helped in the Parayas and Malas and certain Madhyas. That is one point even which you also were saying. The another point which they are saying also, that though we got education, Malas and Parayas, Pallars, they are not allowing us to get into a job. That kind of an argument is also there in South India. And even Valmiki, when I interviewed in the North India, he said, since I am Valmiki, I face so much of discrimination in the in this department. I don't know how to refer his name. Ramesh Bangi. He said that since only because of my Bangi category, I have been discriminated, no promotion also has been given.
This is true, and this is the unique feature of Indian caste system, that even the downtrodden discriminate among themselves. And that is what Dr. Ambedkar has said, that caste gives you a sense of inferiority and sense of superiority. Sense of inferiority when you look upward and sense of superiority when you look downwards. And this is a unique feature of caste system. So this is very much true that a dominating caste in any region might always give a sense of inferiority to another caste, and the other caste would always get a feeling of discrimination. But let us address it logically. If you say that you don't have an, though after education you never got an opportunity for employment, it means that you have to make a claim that the dominating Dalit caste is in the position of employing you. Okay? If that is the case, then you would say that, okay, these people are discriminating with me. But I suppose all those who know the history of last 60 years of India, 66 years of independent India, then in that case the employer himself is a caste Hindu.
No, that is true. For example, okay. For example, you go for a lecture job. In lecture job, you have a what you say is absolutely true. The Dalits also, Madhyas also say.
If I could intervene here at one point of time. Yeah. See, I have a very different experience. Okay. If you go for a lecture job in Pune and around, and the caste Hindus will not prefer to employ a Mahar Buddhist, and they'll prefer to employ some Chalukas who is a non-Mahar. Now, when I try to investigate the reason for this, they say that, see, what happened with this Mahar Buddhist is that they keep on objecting each and everything. Why you have a Satyanarayan Puja, and why you have this photograph of God in your thing? We are getting grants for a government, why you want to do this? If we have people from Chalukas from other background, basically they are Hindus and they have no problem with this. So every region have its own different combinations, or every employment might have its own different combinations for accepting and not accepting.
So this break of relationship, do you see the break of relationship between different castes, like Mahars, Mans as a separate category itself, is a failure of Dalit movement, not bringing
it? Has always been there. It has always been there right from the days of Ambedkar. Let us talk about that. Ambedkar enjoyed the majority support of the Mahars in Maharashtra, but not with other majority classes. Though there were people who were there with individual, we can take Rajbhoj and others who were there with.
There is also a reason for that, no? Even which you were referring earlier. You're saying the education opportunity. Maharashtra was one of the biggest battalion.
Education opportunity, and that is what we are coming to the Pune Pact. So what was done by Gandhi? Who were contesting against Ambedkar? We have Babu Jagjivan Ram as a national figure who was brought against Ambedkar. Okay. So all those caste, all those community was a Chamar. Yeah.
But also like Mahar.
Yeah, a Mahar from that time, you can just...
So you can't compare
that. No, what I'm saying that you have people, if he's there from there. In Maharashtra, you have picked a few people, so the whole people who get elected in the reservation seats, if you see, are those who are non-Buddhist. Or those who are not in Republican politics, if I make it very, very much clear, who are not in Republican politics. So let us be clear with the politics. This is what is the Buddhist politics, is the Republican politics. And therefore what happened, that there are reasons that people with the caste system, they didn't allow you to mingle up with each other. So caste is a problem. Second, the caste Hindus with the politics take opportunity of this and they try to pick a few people. Means if you find that you have the maximum number of the non-Buddhist Dalit getting elected from Shiv Sena and other political parties. What is the reason? Means I told you around 17 members got elected from, I don't know, means 9 members got elected from Shiv Sena out of 21 seats. So it's
all
more than... yeah, and they all are non-Buddhist.
Non-Buddhist Mahars.
Because they are not Mahar, they are non-Buddhist. The combination here is Mahars are Buddhist in Maharashtra.
Okay.
Okay, in the Maharashtra, this common combination is a general rule.
Yeah, general rule, but it is, there are non-Buddhist.
Yeah, they are non-Buddhist. Yeah.
So there is a non-Buddhist Mahars.
Monks. Chamas.
But non-Buddhist Mahars are here?
No.
There are no.
No, there is no phenomenon in Maharashtra of non-Buddhist Mahars.
There are only
Mahars who are converted to Buddhism.
All Mahars are
converted. There was a chain of conversion which went off. Yeah. There's not an exception. So this is the one major...
Ram Athwade?
He's a Buddhist.
But he has an alliance with Rajiv.
So that is a political alliance. Let us understand with us. What he is talking about, being Buddhist is something else.
Yeah.
And he getting alliance with Congress, or he getting alliance with Shiv Sena, or he getting alliance with BJP. Okay, is an alliance of seats. Means we may not appreciate it. We may not appreciate this part.
Maybe the same case. No? For example, let us focus like this. The entire Mahar Buddhism, the Buddhism itself, when you say Mahar Buddhism, when you say Mahar means Buddhist. So that the Buddhism in Maharashtra also never reached to the monks and Buddhists.
Absolutely.
They never reached. That is one failure. So then that kind of a failure, when the Congress gives them an opportunity, okay, you come, I will embrace you, though it is not an embracement, it is rather using them, that is also a fact. But don't you feel that isn't the fact that the Dalit movement and the Buddhism completely failed making exclusively as a Mahar Buddhist?
It has, the roots of Mahar monk disputes are very old in Maharashtra. Okay, so it doesn't start with 1956. Okay, the dispute of Mahar Mang, a dispute of the outcast people among their own caste, is a dispute of interest. Because if you have in the Jajmani system, if you see what were the duties which were given to Mahars and Mangs, one was praised and one was not, and therefore the interests were conflicting with each other. So they have a long conflict of interest all the time. Now when it comes to politics and when it comes to religion, it also happened at many point of time, because you are doing this, I am not doing the other thing. Okay. Because you are converting, because you have a leader and he is your caste, I don't want to get with you. Now this is a unique feature of caste system. Let us not talk about what has happened in Buddhism as that, has dealt with it. If Buddhism has tried to reach with many more people, but we have individual experience of that. We don't have a mass conversion. But Maharashtra is one example where we have the criminal tribes getting converted to Buddhism in a huge number. So it's the Mahas, and the second phase of conversion which came in 2006, and a major part of it are those Ramoshis, Pardis and others. They started converting to Buddhism for in a major role. Now Maharashtra sees another third way of conversion, that certain, not the major dominating OBC class, but other OBC class are converting to Buddhism, and they speak about Ambedkar Buddhism and all the part. They said Buddhism teach you equality, therefore we are looking for equality and Buddhism. So Mahar is working as a catalyst for many areas. So we have to look at this. So it's a multi-dimensional discourse. It cannot be one-to-one or black and white answer for this. So if Mahar-Mang conflict is there, you have in the case of Namantar, the whole Namantar thing for 14 years which happened in Maharashtra, there were four people who died. Okay, out of it, three were monks. And Pochiram Kamble, who died in, who was killed, rather, died means they were killed, they were murdered. Pochiram Kamble, who was murdered, he was a monk. And you know what he was doing? He being a monk, he used to monk. Okay? So he used to address people with Jai Bhim. And that annoyed the caste Hindus, that you are not a Mahar, why are you addressing others with Jai Bhim? And therefore, they catch hold of him, they started beating him. They cut off, chopped his hand, they chopped his legs, and they always keep on saying it, will you say Jai Bhim? And till he died, he used to give slogan of Jai Bhim. Now we have Mang people, this happened at the time of Namantar, the Namantar movement in Maharashtra. You know that the Aurangabad University, there was a demand that it should be named by the name of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, and the whole Marathwada, the Dalit Hutments were torched. So you have Mahars, you have monks who have sacrificed their life for the for Ambedkar movement, and they have converted, they have been here. So it's what we're talking about is not everything is in black and white. So we can't make a general statement for this.
But that is true. But the Bangis, for example, I'm little aware of this Bangis situation. In Bangis in Maharashtra, they're not considered as Marathis, do they? Are they? They're not considered as Marathis.
Yeah, they've been migrating here. That is what has been always been the myth. Or that is what the history they've been telling all the time. That we came here with the Mughal emperor. We came here with somebody else.
So they are also Dalits. I hope
yeah, they are there. They are there.
So they are Dalits. But why the scavenging issue is not addressed at all in many of the Dalit discourses?
I think that is again another myth that it has not been addressed. Rather, Dalit are the first who keep on taking the issue of scavenging. Means if you speak with Manoj Ki, they are the one who have always been talking about this.
No, that is true. I mean to say that, for example, even recently disorganized a conference on the scavenging. I have a different take on scavenging, but what is my point of contention is, for example, take the writings of scavenging in English. Who are those Dalits? Tell me one or two Dalits who have written on scavenging.
I know.
But let us take the Dalit literatures. So that why there is not a political representation of...
Let us understand the Bhangis in Maharashtra and what they really constitute. What the Bhangi does, same thing is done by the Mahars in Maharashtra.
But they are not considered as scavengers. Marathas?
No, no.
Mahars are Buddhists.
No, no, I'm not saying that. If you go to a municipal corporation or if you go anyway, the manual scavenging is done not only by the Bhangis but also by the Mahars.
Yeah.
Okay. And in the village, Maharashtra village community, it was basically the Mahars who used to do all this thing. Right? So, what happened with Ambedkar movement is that they said that we are not going to do this again. We just do away with this part. So, it also has a context
but they
that.
Also had an opportunity.
No,
like army, there was a
no, forget about army. Means they gave up this part when Ambedkar gave a call that give up your traditional work and come to cities.
Yeah.
Do anything, you may die. But give up your traditional work. And they took up the call and everybody left villages and came to cities. And that is how you have a major migration coming to cities. Now this was a call.